Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
Welcome on in to the Utah Blockcast. It's good to be back with you. Cam, it's game week.
It's game week. We finally made it.
We made it. Oh, man, it feels so good.
Breath of fresh air. There's no arsenic still.
No arsenic.
It couldn't get down to the block cave, in the lounge anyway.
No, it couldn't.
No, we're nice and filtered down here.
The only thing that gets down here is air conditioning.
Yeah. Oh, God.
The AC is strong down here.
Which the AC doesn't ever come from outside, so the arsenic.
We're safe.
Yeah, that's good.
It's cold though.
Yeah, no, it's too cold.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Can I borrow a blanket?
No, I need to be sitting on it.
Game week, baby.
Game week. Man, I can't. Every year it feels like I don't know how we made it this far, like how we made it as long as we did, but also. Like, it feels like week one snuck up on us a little bit.
Dude, it's the weirdest thing, right? So all off season, it felt like forever. And then August felt like the longest month. Fall camp started, and normally it feels like that time flies by. But for whatever reason, this season, it was just different. It dragged along. And then all of a sudden, boom, here we are. Monday, game one, week one.
Yeah, July. Did July happen this year?
July did not happen.
I don't recall. I think there were like events in July.
I attended events.
I think there was a swimming pool on a golf course at one.
I've seen pictures.
Yeah. Otherwise, I'm not familiar with that with July 2022. If anyone has any information on that month, If you know its whereabouts, please contact us at BlockcastPod. Huge week, super exciting. Can't believe we finally made it. On that note, if you didn't see our week zero post, it has a nice guide in there of how to prepare for each week. And if you're listening to this on Tuesday, it's not too late to get cracking on your week preparation, especially for week one because it is a big one. One of the weeks I mentioned to my wife last week, coming up mid afternoon was, basically she hit her wall of basically acceptance of the TV being on college football. She's not a fan.
There's probably a lot of wives out there that
I'm sure this is not, I'm not alone in this for sure. Anyway, week zero is a great one to be like, of course, honey. Yeah, well, I'll turn these games off.
Of course.
I don't need to watch this. I'd much rather watch whatever with you. There was definitely an asterisk last week, like, because next week, this isn't going to happen. No. Next week, this TV and this couch and I, we are all one and we will act and be treated as one. That's pretty much the week one we're getting. It's a good slate.
Dude, it's an incredible slate, and we're going to talk more about it here in just a bit, but quick, got to handle some business because we take the mullet approach here, business in front, party in the back. Business first, as always, go to UtahBlockcast.com, check us out, sign up, subscribe, get access to the Discord channel, the Blockcast Discord channel, which is great. We've had a lot of fun with our subscribers so far. It's been really cool to see the support of the Blockheads and everybody that's, whether you subscribe or you're there for free, like it all means a lot to us regardless.
Oh, and it's been fun because there's a lot of folks there that I don't interact with a lot in other, like on Twitter, where there's a group that we interact with more or that, for whatever reasons or maybe follower counts, whatever, it's more easier to interact with them or we interact more commonly with them, see their stuff more often. And the Discord kind of levels a lot of that. And, it's been fun to engage with some folks that we haven't otherwise. And, Yeah, it's been a fun area to chat about, like, F1, and our friend Stu Johnson is setting up a college football fantasy league in there as well, and and it's just getting started. It's a lot of, I think we've got forty some odd block stars in there now, and a handful of block daddies, and it's been fun, and
it's been
we'd
cool.
love for you to come join us. On that note, speaking of business, we had a grace period when we were started. We mentioned that free members, as long as you signed up, would still get newsletters, still get access to most of the articles on site. That is changing as of this week. Those are going to be paid stuff is going to be for paid members. Free stuff is going to be for free members. So free folks, you'll still get like a newsletter or at least a newsletter a month type thing, and then maybe some like updates each week. But paid newsletter stuff will just go to paid subscribers. There was one more part of that now I'm forgetting.
And I wish I knew what you were thinking.
Oh, it was just going to be come join us. If you're a free member, we'd love for you to become a blockhead or blockstar. And if you haven't signed up, we'd love for you to come join us. If you're a listener and you haven't signed up, just go to utahblockcast.com, and there's a bunch of sign up buttons. We're not shy.
And part of this too is that we want to provide a community where we have an opportunity to give back to our blockhead community. And I think we're in the works of planning some things down the road, but in the near future, we have a great opportunity where one of our blockheads actually lives out in Florida, and with the game being in Gainesville, has volunteered to put together a tailgate, which we will obviously be helping contribute there. So if you haven't seen it on Twitter, go to @Florida Utah Fan. Andrew is one of our subscribers. He's putting together the tailgate. Me and Kendra, we're going to be there on site. We'll be there helping him set up everything and having that available to Utah fans. So if you're interested in attending the tailgate, you can hit up Andrew again. His Twitter handle is @FloridaUtahFan. If you're going to be there, please express that you're going to be there, that you're interested in attending, and potentially how many would be there with you. Or you can even tag the Blockcast pod and let us know that you'll be there as well. So we're excited about that. This is kind of a first thing where we're going to contribute to a little event, a tailgate at the Florida game, which we're super excited about.
Yep, and I'll post the information on the Utah Block or the Blockcast Pod Twitter account. So go to @BlockcastPod tomorrow, and there will be some info there. Cool. Anything else? Oh, also business, right? Like, what have you written this week, Steve?
Man, so a lot of game preview stuff, obviously, at UZone, a lot of, looking at stats, looking at numbers, but one thing
Speaking of game previews, by the way, we might have one of those in your inbox this week.
Yes.
Keep an eye out for that.
Oh, yes, a little tease. Man, I'm so excited for those, Cam. You have no idea. Anyways, so I wrote a little thing at UZone, UZone's Monday Musings, just kind of my thoughts on the game, on what it means. You can find that at UZone. I published it as a VIP only story, but I think I'm going to change that to a free story. So as you're reading this, you'll have the opportunity to go, if you're not a subscriber at UZone, to go and read that. Just, man, I'm so excited for Saturday. We'll talk more about the game, obviously, in this episode, but just excited from a bigger perspective of what this means. And again, we'll talk about this, but what this game potentially means for Utah, and just the opportunity to go to a place like Ben Hill Griffin Stadium, the swamp, the history that's there, the
humidity,
tradition, the humidity. Obviously, the biggest threat to Utah is the humidity, and
to
really
everyone
feeling that, and everyone. I don't know how people survive based on what we're reading on Twitter. Like, it sounds.
My understanding is that
place.
A lot don't.
Yeah, no, it's like,
yeah,
I know. What's his face? Andrew Babushka, he mentioned he was going to Florida on I think Friday, that he was stopping.
Gatorade the plane.
Haven't seen him on Twitter. What happened to him?
Haven't the whole thing gone?
He's gone. So
if you track down July 2022 or Andrew, let us know at Blockcast Pod.
So anyways, that was something that I wrote, not your typical like game preview stuff, but more just general thoughts on the game and itself and just kind of what it means. But have you written anything? You reading anything? What are you doing over there?
Just been writing at UtahBlockcast.com. Go check that out. I'm reading right now a couple of things. Reading Chris Brown's basically guide to smart college football. If you haven't read it, you should check it out. But also read today the Athletic's kind of roundtable college football playoff picks article. If you haven't seen that, we tweeted that from Blockcast Pod as well. If you don't have an Athletic subscription, then I'll give you a little bit of a TLDR, but a lot of people very high on Utah, and the consensus is really, let's see what week one looks like. There's a lot riding on Utah in week one, but there's a lot of confidence nationally right now that, frankly, I think of their panel, the majority had Utah in one of their four spots.
6 of 9.
Woo!
6 of 9. That's almost 69.
That's a pretty nice ratio.
Yeah.
Pretty nice ratio of athletic writers have you in their college football playoff. I think in that article, Nicole Arbach called out this game specifically and said, like, kind of called out the elephant in the article there. Like, what is this Utah team? It feels like a lot hinges on this game.
Yeah.
And it feels like, you know, there's 6 of 9 athletic. There's some really nice athletic writers who are saying Utah's gonna be that fourth team, or in some of their cases, I think they even had them higher than fourth. Does Utah need to win on Saturday for that to happen?
Well, man, that's such a simple but such a good question, right? Because there are layers to it, I think, right? Like, is it absolutely necessary? No, it's not, because we learned last year that they can still achieve good things. But if we're talking like playoff, honestly, I think it is necessary that they win on Saturday. It is a must-have win for Utah, because I think it's...
So who is it a must-win for? So that kind of gets to where I'm thinking about it. Do you see this as a must-win for Utah, or is this a must-win for Utah fans? Who needs this win more right now, Utah fans or
what's the Utah football team? If the goal is the college football playoff.
Okay, it's fair. Is it? Is that the goal of this team? I know that there's been some vagaries about Kyle Whittingham saying he thinks this team, and I think in the article they even mentioned that Kyle has said that he thinks this team could do it. But yeah. is that a stated goal with this team?
Players have talked about it. Players have certainly talked about it. I don't know if coaches have.
Okay, you know, I know Kyle's always just been always so much about win your conference.
Yeah.
Like, or it's bowl eligibility and then win the conference. And like, those are his two things.
Mm-hmm.
And it would just be very surprising to me
yeah.
if he had outwardly kind of spoken about like, we think this team is capable of being, and that is a goal. Because I've been outspoken on this podcast. I personally don't know if I think that is for me. Is a realistic goal, period. And I don't know, just because, and really more on the term, I say that really more on the national championship scale, like, and so that's kind of how I think about the playoffs and when I package it. Utah's absolutely capable of being a playoff team and this season. I don't know if Utah mostly statistically has what it takes to become a national championship team, is where most of my doubt lies. But it does... To me, it would just be surprising to me to hear Witt have that much outward confidence in his team.
I agree, and I'm with you there. It would be surprising to hear him say those words, but players have talked about it. Like, I remember talking to Brant Keithy week one of fall camp. You know, he's like, our goal isn't just like getting back to the Rose Bowl. Like, yeah, if we get there, that it's a great season, but. You know, why can't we do more? Like, that's our mindset. Why can't we make the college football playoff?
What a mindset for all of us to have. Why can't we do more?
Yeah.
Some days less.
Some days you need to.
Honestly, on Saturday, I'm going to be like, honey, why can't we do less?
Why can't we?
Those are the vinyl letters I want. Why can't? Accept less.
Why can't we? But no, so I think like if the goal is making it to the playoff, I think Florida is a must win. But if it's not, if it is still, and I'm sure that they're not just the goal is not just bowl eligibility, right?
Like not this
we
year.
We can all agree that this season is not just about getting that sixth game.
It would
threshold.
Have to take a turn.
Yeah, that's
if
that's
week
a dark,
10, we were like, where's that
dark
sixth
hole
win?
To go down? Yeah, let's not go there. Oh, man. Oh, geez.
If we get to Stanford and we don't have a sixth win,
oh boy,
are we even still doing this? We might have refunded a bunch of money and signed off.
Yeah, that would be a really dark time for all of us.
a tough couple of months.
So I think it is all dependent on what the goal is, right?
And so I think, we saw last year, right? Last year, Utah, in a lot of senses, accomplished as much or more than they ever have. They obviously didn't win the Rose Bowl as hordes of BYU fans will tell you.
BYU fans watch that game too.
Yeah, BYU fans on Twitter, will tell you. They'll remind you that Utah, in fact, lost that game. They accomplished so much last year that, frankly, wasn't very expected, especially because of that start and a poor start. And so seeing that last year, I kind of think back to myself. Now, Utah was 9-3, had a couple of ugly losses, one really ugly loss. But like, if say they don't lose to Oregon State, a game that was relatively close, for most of the game, say they come back and pull it off against San Diego State, even with a loss to BYU, with the way Utah was playing last year, Utah's probably, especially last year, the college football playoff was a little weird at the top.
Weird.
There was some movement late in the season that we don't always see. Frankly, Michigan beat Ohio State.
I was thinking the same thing.
which we don't
see that very often.
that in itself, as we were like, the college football playoff was weird last year. What a weird season. I mean, COVID season was weird, but last year Michigan beat Ohio State.
Weird. Yeah, that's awkward.
Which, COVID was bad, but that was weird. No, but anyway, like that team, you know, a couple fewer losses. I mean, it obviously is saying a lot, but a loss to BYU last year and that team's in the mix. A loss to Florida this year is to me supposed to eliminate Utah from the playoffs, when a loss to BYU last year retroactively, I think, probably wouldn't have. I don't know. And so I don't think this game is necessarily an elimination game from college football playoff. I think a lot of people will say that when it happens, right?
Sure.
You're going to hear, you're going to see the tweets. If Utah loses, there's going to be a million tweets that all say, and the Pac-12 has been eliminated from the playoff, yada, yada, whatever. The Pac-12's best shot of going to the college football playoff was just eliminated. It's just not true.
Right.
If you're going to lose, lose early.
And I think, you know, and we've seen that over the last couple of years with Utah, you know, 2019, they lose to USC and you're like, oh, well, there goes this season. I mean, it ended really poorly. But still,
Honestly, you're in
the actual championship game.
Utah was Oregon losing to Arizona State that season from going to the Rose Bowl.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
That's how razor thin the margins are there, right? Like, if Oregon just doesn't lose an inexplicable road game in November because of bad Pac-12 scheduling.
Because of, yeah.
Yeah, among other things.
well, I really want to say it. Allegedly, other things.
If Utah doesn't, but that's the type of thing we might talk about on the Discord channel. if if Oregon doesn't lose that game to Arizona State, Utah's in the Rose Bowl that season.
I think about that, right? And I hate that we're going back to 2019 because we shouldn't. But like, if Oregon's in that game and they didn't suffer that loss a couple weeks earlier, there's pressure on them. They're coming into that game with a lot more pressure than they
were. Absolutely.
You know, like, and you think just what kind of impact could that have on the game, right? So anyways, back to this season. We're still hurting.
Listen, I am not done analyzing the
pain.
I am not done
season.
Analyzing the hypothetical psychological effects on the Oregon team.
We're still
had they
out.
Beat Arizona State.
Gosh.
Oh man.
Damn you, Antonio Pierce.
That game's never gonna quite. That game's never gonna quite.
Gosh.
Anyway, but what were we talking about?
We were talking about what were we talking about? Florida, I'm sure we were talking
something about
them.
Florida. I just don't think this game is a college football playoff eliminator for Utah. I think again, early in the season, you're gonna get a lot of that discussion. It's just not true. We see right. it so many times of teams creeping their way back up, and Utah has
allowed the rest of the season to play out. Other yes. teams will lose games, and you have
good games on your schedule. Yes. You don't need this game to be a victory because USC is going to be a highly ranked game. Oregon's going to more than likely be a ranked team. Who knows what else you might UCLA could easily be. They're going to be competitive. They could easily be ranked. There's so much left of the season, and being in the Pac-12, they're not going to have any trouble recovering there. And frankly, they're taking huge advantage of this early ranking. Being ranked seventh is something where an early loss is something you can recover from. Utah hasn't had that, top 10 privilege before. And, you know, and now that Utah's got it, I'm not mad. I'm happy for them to take advantage of it.
Yeah.
You know, I do think this game's important. I'm really eager to see, but to me, it's more important as a kind of indication of is this team in 2019, we talked about this when Utah lost to USC. We talked about this team has shown repeatedly at times that sometimes the lights are too bright. Yeah. And I don't know if that's a Utah football thing. I don't know if that's a college football thing, you know,
yeah.
And I suspect probably more the latter. But, like, is Utah going to come out in primetime, on ESPN, Gainesville, week one? There's going to be 3 million people watching that game.
Easily.
And it's going to be a tough environment in front of 85,000 people. It's going to be humid, I've heard. It's going to be who knows what else.
The Florida humidities. I'm terrified.
It's hard to breathe now just thinking about it.
This humidity right now?
Do you hear me? I'm wheezing.
Pumped through my veins. Is that the humidity I feel? It's cold.
Yeah, it's cold.
Or is
cold.
It warm? Is humidity warm or cold?
I think it's both.
Okay.
It's both warm and cold. That's what's so bad about
That's
it.
That's what's... It gets you both ways.
Yeah. It gets you sweating and then you freeze.
Ooh.
Ooh, it's very tough. Anyway.
kills you from the inside and the outside.
Is Utah ready for that, though? You know, it's because they normally warm up with slower games. 2015 Michigan. If you go back and watch that game was ugly at times.
It was.
Utah had its ugly moments. Like, we're going to see those on Saturday. We're going to see some ugly moments. We're going to see them from both teams.
The good news is you have a quarterback in Cameron Rising that can do a lot of good things that I'm not sure you could say that back in 2015.
We sure tried to say those things. God bless him.
God, yeah.
You know, God.
The bulldog, maybe.
God bless Travis Wilson.
Gave his heart to the program.
Gave everything. But yes, absolutely, the program is today in more capable hands. And frankly, off the field with Andy Ludwig and with Morgan Scally and with the staff that they have put together, I think that they have... it's hard to say as good of a staff as they've ever had because of that Urban Meyer staff, but really a loaded staff and a really, really the most probably talented offense they've ever had. Really going to be so much fun.
So what would a big win against Florida mean for Utah? Obviously being number seven, And the thing of this is like this weekend, you know, it's not just Utah and Florida, but you look at the week one schedule, and we'll probably talk about this later in the episode. But you look at the other games on the slate this weekend, there are some opportunities for teams ranked ahead of Utah where they're going to take a loss because they're playing other teams ranked ahead of Utah or ranked in the top 25, right? And so what is the impact? What is the significance of Utah getting a win, understanding with knowing that there are probably going to be teams that potentially take a loss that are ranked, you know, around them? Like, I think there's a pretty big significance here.
I mean, it's massive. Among other reasons, just getting a big win on the road in week one in primetime. Like, oh, I really,
that's huge.
It's I really can't understate the primetime week one thing. I don't have the numbers in front of me. That game could easily do 3 million viewers. And which would basically be, Utah's biggest regular season game, I think, probably ever. Again, if you know that I'm wrong on that, I'm not that concerned about it. It would be massive for them. I think a big win probably propels them into the top, like the top five conversation. Right now they are about 40 or, you know, 33 points behind, the top five, Notre Dame at the top five. So they'd have to make some movement there, but Notre Dame plays in week one. They play Ohio State. Even if they show up and look good in that game against Ohio State, they'll probably still drop, just nature of getting a loss. Utah making up some of that gap there. Texas A&M, right ahead of them, is only ahead of them by 3 points in the voting. That'd be an easy one to jump. If Utah has a good showing against Florida. And I think that will make a difference, right? I think if Utah has a big game, if Utah has a big showing and say, I don't know, we see something like 37-7, right? Like a big blowout for Utah. I think that's massive. I think it propels the conversation right out of the gate that a Pac-12 team kicked the crap out of an SEC team and you know, that team was Utah. Doing that in primetime week one would propel you through for the rest of the season as a college football playoff favorite. Now, winning a close game against Florida, you know, maybe not, maybe less so. Mm-hmm. It's still, you're not going to see any movement. You're certainly not going to fall. Winning a week one SEC game on the road, again, just people seeing you on TV, it sounds so stupid. Just people seeing you on TV in primetime with that number on your name will tell them in their mind that you are good. That reinforcement will help so much, even if it's a close fought game, even if the score is close, even if you lose a close game, frankly. If you look good, if you have good moments, it will have a positive impact.
Absolutely.
Basically, what I'm saying is, don't get blown out.
Right.
Don't get blown out in primetime. You get blown out in primetime, oh boy.
That's not
good. That's probably getting you out of the college football playoff.
Yeah.
You can't get blown out in primetime in week one and then go to the college football playoff.
And something else to kind of add to your point of just how valuable these games are, you know, this is impacting the future of the program because of what this means for recruiting. Like, recruits watch these games. Chase Kennedy, defensive end, freshman out of Dallas, signed with Utah this year, true freshman. He's been talked about in fall camp as a guy that could potentially play this season. You know, a lot of reason to be optimistic about his future at Utah. A big reason why he committed to Utah, he was on his official visit at Houston during the Utah-Oregon game at Rice-Eccles Stadium. He could not take his eyes off the game while he was on his official visit at Houston.
Wow.
Yeah. So
wow.
Recruits will watch games, and it has an impact. So when you...
What are the TVs like there in Houston? They got to change Houston, the channel.
What are you doing? Yeah. Why are you showing anything but Houston highlights on your official visits?
That's red and white. Maybe they thought it was... They were just, you know, they weren't paying attention. They were just walking by and saw, they're like, yeah, okay. That looks like just going about there. And then they got back.
My thought was,
they got back and were just like, oh, shit.
I just remember him talking. And I'm like, wait, you weren't watching like just Houston all weekend? He's like, nah, like we were at dinner and they had the game on. Like I was watching. I couldn't, I had it pulled up on my phone at one point, too. Like, I was watching that game. And so, like, that's the thing.
That's wild. And that's not even – see, and that's what I mean is that's not even that much exposure.
Yeah.
He was at dinner and saw Utah playing on TV.
And it that made an impact, a lasting impact.
These types of marginal – like, it sounds so silly, but the TV ratings matter.
They do. You're in homes. You don't know who's watching. Sometimes you do know who's watching. Sometimes you are telling recruits to watch this game.
Those are political ads you're seeing. There's a reason you're seeing them, and there's a reason that they spend so much money on them. They work, and, like, it sucks, but they work. And, like, so what I'm saying is so do high – or so do low numbers next to your team's ranking in prime time in week one as long as you don't get blown out.
Yes.
Just don't get blown out.
Don't get blown out.
That should be the cheer. Maybe something more positive than that.
How can we do less?
do less getting blown out.
Do less blowing out.
Ooh.
That sounded bad.
we'll workshop that.
Oh, man. Anyways, so this game is pretty significant, right, for Utah season. Looking at this game, Cam, what would you say is Utah's – what do you feel is Utah's biggest advantage? Offensively. Let's start offense.
Offensively. That's really tough. I think that, broadly speaking, I am expecting it to be – kind of just the middle of the field in general. I think Utah will be able to run the ball well. I think Utah will be able to run the ball well between the tackles, specifically. I think that Utah will, just by nature of the strengths of the offense, be able to do stuff with their tight ends. I think that Utah's... I mean, all we've talked about through fall camp is that this offensive line unit has had so much time to gel. Mm-hmm. Depth charts came out today. No surprises. We see a unit that we expected to see for weeks, and that is massive. Plus, if you look at the games played and the starts next to those players, there's a lot of experience coming with that group, even though they're young. Really bullish on that group and Tavion Thomas in the run game. And then, I mean, obviously just Cam Dalton and Brant in the middle of the field. I think Utah, it'll be a good indication to me, kind of a microcosm of, maybe not a microcosm, but just a nice early look at what Utah is going to be trying to do in Pac-12 play right out of the gate.
Yeah. I think that's great. I think you're really onto something there with the middle of the field because, you know, I think of the matchup here between Utah and Florida. And I start initially thinking about the advantage with the run game, but then, you know, Cameron's decision make, you know, Rising's decision making is so good. And he's
Mine
so
too.
Good. It is very good too.
My middle of the field decision making.
Because your decision making
I do
is about
so
doing
much
less.
Less.
You know, you don't put a lot on. It's
you know what?
Less.
I will say like, so in a, not this, I mean this with all due respect, Cam has a certain attitude, a certain do-less attitude about
him. He does.
Yeah.
Dude, it's so refreshing listening to Cam sometimes because he keeps it so simple. He, like, you talk about him like, what was your message to the team? Let's have fun. That's all it needs to be.
I love it.
Right? Like, that was his message to the team last year. Let's just have fun.
Yeah.
Just keep it simple.
You know what? Before he came out there, that team was not having fun.
They were not having fun.
And you know what?
They were miserable.
Maybe that's the message they need. They need it.
Just have fun.
Zen master.
He is the Zen master.
Do a little less.
He is the Zen master. So,
anyway,
I was saying like going back and forth between the run game and Cameron's decision making, the tight ends, and I think that you're really onto something there. Where the middle of the field is probably Utah's biggest advantage here, where you are able to, I have confidence in Utah's ability to, you know, generate a solid run game, with Tavion Thomas, with the offensive line, with the tight ends that they have that will be assets in the run game as well. Not just not getting carries per se. I'm also not saying that.
I mean, we've seen it.
We've talked about it a lot.
We've seen it and with a lot of success.
Yeah, and a lot of success. So, but they're so effective, you know, as additional blockers on the line of scrimmage, it really allows Utah to do some things with the run game that really benefits the players, specifically Tavion Thomas, because his skill set getting downhill, you know, as just that big body, you know, and he's got that one, he's like a one cut type of guy where he finds the gap, the crease, and he's,
you know, well, and in the open field, he's so hard to bring down and to tackle just to get your arms around him.
Yeah.
He's so well at even once he, like you said, once he gets downhill, he explodes downhill. And then in that open field, he can still be so elusive. It is when you watch, I was watching the highlights of the USC game from last year, and his third quarter breakaway touchdown for the 42-yard run, I think it is. He comes through the line of scrimmage pretty much untouched, has a great hole. But when he comes through in the linebacker, he very much just kind of brushes the linebacker off of
it. It's so wild watching him just kind of like run through tackles like he's unfazed.
Yeah, just tackling dummies all over the field. But I'm curious how you mentioned tight ends as blockers. How does losing a guy like Cole Fotheringham, who was Utah's best blocking tight end, where does Utah make that up this year, or do they?
They do. And I think what's going to be interesting is, you know, Cole was so efficient as a blocker because he was good understanding angles. He was stout. What will be interesting is the guys that they have, Logan Kendall, the Rhino. We've all talked about him. Thomas Yasmin, guy that is just an incredible athlete, first and foremost. 6'5", 250, he's a tough guy. The difference in where you could potentially see a greater impact is that these guys are more tenacious in a way, where Cole was so good at gaining the advantage from a positional situation. Like, he was just so good at gaining advantage positionally, and just, you know, he was good. He was there. He was set. He got the advantage, got the angle, and that
Cole
was it.
Cole was just so, like, what, I guess, like, schematically, fundamentally, he was, yeah, I guess, knew his playbook.
Yeah, and he had some moments where he had some pancake blocks where he drove guys off the line of scrimmage, put them in on their back. He had those moments, but more often than not, you know, he was doing what he needed to do. And gaining the advantage from, you know, again, positional angles and all that type of stuff. Whereas with guys like Logan Kendall and Thomas Yasmin, these are guys where they can move people and they can drive people against their will. And that's kind of an exciting thing.
Got a little bit more. Are you saying they got a little bit more dog in them?
A little more, you know, maybe a little more dog in them. A little more, you know, just.
Before it sounds like maybe we're bagging on Cole Fotheringham, reminder that no, we are one of the original lovers of Cole Fotheringham.
Very much.
Go back to the 2019 tapes. We have the proof. We have the receipts. But that as of
it's just different. Right?
As of reading That's this, by I'm the way, Cole Fotheringham still an active roster member of the Raiders, of the Las Vegas Raiders.
Yeah.
So,
and like that's so. Like, that's the thing. It's just different, right? Like, Cole was so good and so efficient, whereas these guys, they're going to have to prove themselves. They're going to have to, like, be fundamentally sound, and that's something that you know, I'm talking about them, you know, driving guys off the line of scrimmage. They have to prove that they can, you know, engage properly, come with proper technique, and all those types of things. But, you know, the potential is there where they could be a greater impact in the run game potentially. From that perspective.
So tell me a little bit about who they would then be blocking, because I know Florida, like on that defensive front seven, what does that look like for Florida? Those tight ends, typically in a normal scheme, you would expect the tight end blocking on the line to probably either be blocking like down toward the middle of the line, against like a defensive end, or moving down to like a linebacker or a safety in the run game, or perhaps if they're split out and a corner's ahead of them, they would be going down to, you know, kind of block a corner in open space. But Florida's defensive ends, they align a little bit differently. They've got, I guess maybe you could tell us a little bit more about that. They do a little bit of different stuff with their front than maybe what we'd see from kind of a more traditional 4-3 college football defense.
So it's, you know, essentially it's a 4-2-5 defense, right, is essentially what it is. But what they do is they have three down linemen and then a fourth, which is kind of a hybrid defensive end linebacker type. So a guy like Nate Orchard or
Nate Orchard's a great comparison. Yeah.
Yeah.
But Nate Orchard was small compared to these guys.
Brent Cox was, he's 6'3", 250 and very, he's quick. Mika Tafua with maybe a little bit more explosiveness. Like that's the kind of athlete we're talking about with Brenton Cox. He was injured last year, but still was a guy that got, I think, 14 and a half tackles for loss, something like 10 sacks, I think.
And he's the stand-up.
Stand-up guy. You've got another guy in Princely, Yumi. I'm not going to try to say it. I've tried to say it, and I can't say it, but he's got a wild last name. But Princely is his first name. He's a guy, 6'5", 245. He's a guy that looks more like Trevor Riley, but he's their base end in this defense. And so they'll do a lot of different things. They'll simulate pressures where it looks like they're going to blitz linebackers. It looks like they're going to zone blitz maybe and then drop out. They'll do a lot of different things. So it's going to be important for Cam to be aware of all of that, for the offensive line to be aware of all that. But when you have a guy like Logan Kendall, you have a guy like Thomas Yasmin, he's going to be so valuable in the run game where he can block a guy like Brenton Cox. He can block a Princely defensive end. And that frees up your tackle to assist down on the defensive tackle who's a former five-star recruit or a nose tackle who's 415 pounds, which we might see on Ooh. Saturday. Ooh. We may not. But still, there's the possibility that we see, I can't remember his name, but he's 415 pounds. He won't be hard to miss. And so that's what that does. And then with Logan Kendall himself, he's versatile enough where he can be a tight end. He can line up like Cole Fotheringham as a traditional inline tight end next to the tackle, or you can put him in the backfield as a fullback where he can take on potentially defensive tackles.
Utah.
Or linebacker, inside linebacker.
Utah has a fullback.
It's awesome.
On the depth chart.
Yeah, shout out to Tyson Maul. He's loving it.
I gotta say, the fullback on the depth chart, since we're going here, has to hurt the 0-5 formation chances. It's pretty hard to put Brant Keithy. It's pretty hard to put Brant Keithy in the backfield with your running back, or I guess in this case without a running back.
It doesn't though, Cam. You put him behind Logan Kendall, and then you put your three other tight ends.
I can't wait for it to be like a 14 personnel and that one running back is the fullback and you're just like, it could have been a tight end.
We were so close.
Like, you didn't have to do that.
Damn it, Andy.
Anyway, sorry, where were we? Blocking those good defensive, I guess it sounds like Florida has a really talented front four.
Yeah. Very talented front four, starting four. Depth is a little bit of a concern for them, apparently. They're not too confident in the depth on the defensive line, but they've got some studs on that.
Ooh, how much
starting?
How much do you care about that in week one, though?
That's kind of the thing, like, right? It's like how much will that matter in week one, where you're your freshest, you're your healthiest, right?
Yeah, I mean, depth, obviously. Yeah, that's... It doesn't bode well for Florida late in the season, but I wonder how much of an effect that will have game one, especially like early game one, right? Mm-hmm. But I mean, you're still rotating guys through the first half. It's probably better game one than game two or three, because one of the things, I mean, we talked about last episode or the episode before, you're still getting your game legs, those first. Yeah. Like, you still need to get in game shape, and you don't really know what that is until you actually get hit. Like, when you're tired and it's the third quarter and you have to go block down on, like, you have to go like make a block on a safety downfield who's going to be running downhill at you, and he's running downhill at you and you take that hit, that's a different kind of tired.
Yep.
That is a tired you can only understand when you feel it. And every year it feels like that first game, as someone who used to play not at a high level or anything, it always felt like that first game you kind of had to,
you know.
Yeah. Not even at a medium level.
Yeah.
We didn't even do it at an adequate level, frankly. Sub-adequate. What I'm saying is, as someone who was beat up a lot on Friday evenings.
Battered and bruised.
No, that first game, though,
it's
you
tough.
Got the crap kicked out of you.
Oh, yeah.
And then it felt like game two, you were breezing through those kind of walls you were hitting.
Well, and even mentally, you clean up a lot of your mistakes. There's so much to iron out from game one for players, for coaches. That's why you hear coaches talk about it all the time. The most progress you make in a season is from week one to week two, from game one to game two, just because of that very thing. You're getting reacclimated with live game action and what that means, both physically but also mentally.
And you got to think that Utah, again, if your biggest improvements are from week one to week two, then presumably you have to like Utah's chances being more. I mean, Florida is across the board, again, with star ratings wise, more talented.
Super talented. Holy
so
cow.
Much more talented.
They have I did an article that'll be on UTZone soon, but so much talent.
It's just unbelievably more talented on both sides of the ball. But this Utah team feels like they should be more cohesive, more prepared.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, Florida's got a new head coach, a whole new system coming in.
Whole new system.
With Billy Napier.
Yeah.
And Utah has, I mean, one of the best consistency in terms of, coaching staffs in the entire country year over year. But also with so much returning production, particularly on offense. Utah returns something like, and this is a big reason why so many of the athletic writers were so big on Utah in that article, which again, go check out. It's, I think we reposted it. I'll make sure we do again if I didn't. But one of the reasons that so many people are so high on Utah is that returning production that they have on both sides of the ball. And you have to think that bodes well, even though Utah's traveling a long way, even though there will be a lot of water in the air. It bodes well for Utah to have the more consistent, right? The freezing, scalding air.
Mm-hmm.
It bodes well that Utah has the experience coming in and the consistency coming in that Florida is missing right now.
Yeah, and that's certainly going to be a factor in this game. And I think you hear, coaches kind of allude to it that, yeah, it's a benefit having guys return because you're starting at an advantage, in your preparation for the season. You can get through things quicker. You can get through putting in your foundational elements of an offense, of a defensive game, not game plan, but scheme, much
Florida,
quicker.
I'll tell you this right now. Florida has at most half of their playbook in right now. They just can't say where Utah has probably the majority of their playbook installed because so much of this offense is returning from last year. Mm-hmm. They don't have to plug in a lot of new guys. Utah can open up their playbook a lot week one if they want to. Florida simply can't. They don't have the plays.
Yeah.
Bringing in a new system. Granted, again, all of these college football systems, it's not like this is a massive change that they all have to relearn how to play football. But those little things matter when you come into halftime adjustments and it's like, man, I really wish we had this counter set in place because we could. It's like, but we haven't run it through yet. So
right.
We can try to draw it up at halftime and scheme it out, but then we're running it for the first time live in a game against a really good team.
You never do that.
It's gonna go bad.
Yeah.
In the business world, we would say you never test in production, and that goes doubly true for installing offense in college football games. You never install offense in production.
Wisely said. Yes.
Test in practice.
You test in practice.
Anyway, I've said enough there. I'm sorry.
No, I was just gonna say. So, conversely, we've talked a lot about where Utah has an advantage. Where's your biggest concern? I'll start here. And for me, it's actually on the defense side of the ball and their ability to stop the run. With Utah, we've talked a lot about what they return on the offense and how that will benefit them. You lose a guy like Devin Lloyd, Nephi Sewell, make it to food. That's a lot up front to lose. And even Hoati Pututau, who is maybe one of the most underappreciated players to come through the program, just was so consistent through his time here. But you have to replace a lot on the defensive front. And so you do have some exciting pieces returning this year, but you've got to match up against the Florida team that, you know, their strength on the offensive side of the ball may be their offensive line. They return a number of guys from that unit last year. They add a guy from Louisiana, two guys from Louisiana, actually, that have familiarity, have history, have playing time in Napier's system. Like, they're not, you know, starting behind the block here. Like, they're starting with a good advantage here. So it,
which,
know,
again, and such an underrated, we talked about it last time. What's the hardest thing for someone to come in and, or I think we talked about it last, oh no, we talked about it, just we talked about it just over the weekend.
Saturday, yeah.
What's the hardest position to plug into? And, an offensive line, it, you know, contrary to the person's belief who you know, kind of sparked the conversation on Twitter, contrary to that person's belief, like, offensive line is a tough thing to just plug into. So that experience coming in from UL with Coach Napier will make a difference.
Yeah.
But I guess, how do you think that gels? I guess, do you think those, that unit has gelled enough, or is talented enough to, I mean, Utah's front four is good. You know, they're more experienced than their linebacker group. Do you think they're ready for that offensive line, or do you think this is, you know, we hear a lot about, you know, is this the capital R real SEC offensive line?
Right, right. And I think that's that. I don't know. Like, that's where I'm at. Like, I'm confident in Utah's ability to be stout against the run,
yeah,
to limit the running rushing attack. But looking at that offensive line and what they have, you know, Florida, Utah was a program that averaged 5.58 yards per carry. Florida was 5.48. So they're right there. It's a good unit. It's a good rushing attack. They've added to that group. They've added to their running back room as well. So there's talent there. There's potential there. And there's talent on the defensive side as well with Utah, with their defensive front, with the guys that they have in that tackle rotation, with the guys that they have at linebacker. There's a lot of athleticism. Like, I'm certainly, like, more than just optimistic, but it is my biggest area of concern in this game. And so, you know, I'm curious to see how it plays out. But what would you say is your biggest area of concern?
I have two. My biggest, ironically, there are my areas of concern are physically large. The receivers. Whittingham touched on it. I'm a little concerned about Utah on the edges. Florida's big. Florida's
their receivers are big.
Their receivers.
Yes.
Their receivers.
They are big.
Florida's receivers are very big. They're like 6'4", 6'5".
220.
Just
210.
Exactly what you want in a receiver. Pick them out of a catalog.
That's what I love. Like, so we were at the press conference and Kyle was asked, like, what do you think is Florida's best positional group? And here I am like, oh, it's offensive line. It's defensive line. Like, it's one of those. Like, no, he's like, he thought about it for a sec, and he's all, they're receivers, they're big. That was the first thing he said.
They're huge.
Like, they're like,
huge.
Sure, okay, like, yeah, we could go with that. They're big.
They're very big. Like,
they're athletic, too.
Who was Stanford's big one? The JJ?
Elijah something. No,
they're old, from a couple years ago.
Oh, JJ Arcega-Whiteside.
Yeah, because that's basically his size.
Yeah. And basically, Florida has three of those guys.
Three of them. And I'll tell you.
And Ricky Pearsall.
I'll let you guess whether or not they're fast. You know? But also, I mean, and on flipping sides of the ball there, too. Like, just conversely, I think of this Utah team, I think its weakest offensive or its weakest position group on offense is probably the receivers, and I think that they're probably, as much as I hate to say it, probably a little outmatched compared to Florida's DBs. Who
Florida is just like a DB factory.
They're going to be good.
Yeah,
they're going to be very good at DB. Utah's going to have a lot of time. A lot. It's going to be tough for Utah to get space on the outside.
So here's. Going back to their receiver room, their three starting receivers, So their X receiver, Justin Shorter, 6'4", 223. Their Y receiver, which is
probably good. You want one of those.
Yeah, they're nice. Your Y receiver, which is kind of like your Solomon Enos, 6'3", 206. And then their inside guy is probably Xavier Henderson, 6'3", 195. So 6'3", across the board.
6'3", 195. So, yeah. So imagine if Utah's Britton Covey was 6'3".
Oh, that would be so
is essentially
dope.
What we're.
That would have been so cool.
Yeah, like if, man, I just
if he could still move the same, Britton Covey, like move the same at 6'3".
I mean, you just can't, right? You couldn't. They can't, right?
Britton Covey could.
Right? But, like, Florida's guys can't, right?
They can't, no.
There's no way, right?
Only Britton Covey could.
Yeah, okay, good. Good. Agreed, okay, agreed.
That's a scary thought.
Whew. But, yeah, I'd say probably there. So I'm curious, though, because number two goes along with the receivers, in a sense. Let's talk about Anthony Richardson.
Okay. Top 10 talent.
Top 10 talent.
Huh? Man, I would love to throw 63 passes and be called the top 10 pick. Give
they'd
me
have
that
to
draft
be,
analysis.
They'd have to be really good passes.
Like,
right?
Really good.
They'd have to be. If you were to throw 63 passes,
I would
and
expect
someone,
like 10
and
of them
someone
to be
were
touchdowns.
To say that person, this incoming sophomore, will be a top 10, is a top 10 talent, top 10 pick.
Like, I would expect the angels to, like, sing from the heavens anytime.
Angels in the end zone.
Yeah, just anytime he threw the ball. It's just, time slows down, but the ball is still the same speed. Still has the same velocity. That's what I would expect.
I can't say that.
63 passes.
To be fair to Anthony Richardson, I that's his name, right?
Yeah, of
course. I don't want to be disrespectful.
He's a top 10 tick, bro.
Yeah. Sorry, no,
top
that's
10
me.
Pick.
That's my bad.
I think it's a tick.
I'm really not trying to be disrespectful, but in his defense, he does like have the physical mold of what a top 10 pick would look like at quarterback, right? And he is supposedly has 4.3 speed. He's what 6.3 as well. Mm-hmm. I didn't see his actual like player profile. But he's got great size. He moves very well.
6'4", 230, 240. He's basically like their Jaquindon Jackson.
But of his 64 passes, 5 of them were interceptions.
Oh. That's not good.
That's a lot. That's a lot of interceptions for 65 passes.
That's one every 12, 13 passes?
13 or so. So every third drive, roughly, if you throw a lot. I get the impression they're not going to throw a ton, which is a bummer for them because they have such big receivers, as we've mentioned, for that reason though. But he does have, he's fast. He is fast.
He
can run. And Utah's got young linebackers. And if they put him in some RPO sets, if they put him in some read option sets where they
QB
put some of Utah's,
sets.
Yeah. Or QB power, where they put him one-on-one with some young Utah linebackers who, you know, if they're a step out of position or if they're, you know, just, again, out-athleted by, but it happens. Like, he is the type of player who can get loose in the open field and who could do it repeatedly. And so I'm a little nervous there, too.
Yeah.
I think the top 10 thing is ridiculous.
Very much. Don't put that.
It's not fair to him.
It's not fair to him.
It's not fair. It's really not. He's not Cam Rising. It's not his fault.
No. He's not.
Our fans will be pissed if they hear this. We've been talking so much shit on their humidity, and now we're talking shit on their quarterback. No, but I, like, if he is a top 10, truly a top 10 talent, if that's who, like, Utah might be in trouble on Saturday. Is that fair? Like,
talking so much shit on their humidity.
Lizzie, it's the thing they're most proud of. It's their most important. It's their, like, if when they flash the game factors where it's just like, what'll Florida's X factors be for this week? And it'll be like, well, it's wet as hell out here. I can barely breathe. My shirt is stuck to me. And they'll be like, oh my God.
Could you just, like, Imagine Utah fans, just Utah Twitter, like, oh, the elevation, it's no factor. What? Just the reaction.
I think they would. I think they would react that way. Like, what? You don't think the elevation? What?
Whoa.
What?
They call Greg Rubel on
come
him.
Come here.
No.
Come listen to this. Read. Tell him what you told me.
Elevation?
No, but like, the elevation's worse than the humidity.
Way worse.
Way worse.
Come on.
Like, we're going to be, like, I'm sorry. Utah's going to be, like, playing at low levels. They're going to be superpowers down there.
I can't wait till next year when they have to come to Salt Lake and we can turn this, we can flip this.
They're
going to
be wishing
them.
It was humid because yeah. They're going to be like, why doesn't y'all's air have water in it? It's so dry.
What?
Like, why does y'all's air have so much sand in it?
Would
arsenic.
We want the humidity or do we want the dry heat? Do we want that humidity? Would that make it worse for them, you think? Humidity plus elevation?
Oh, man. I don't know. I'll have to. Well, let's consult a meteorologist.
Okay. Sorry. Anyways. Major tangent. But yes, Anthony Richardson, getting back to it, very talented player. Unfair to put those kind of projections on him, those, you know, calling him top 10 pick in next year's draft based on 64 passes. It's just not fair to him. It's not right. There's just so much.
If he turns out to be Cam Newton, then we'll be wrong, and that'll be great for him and for Florida.
Yeah.
And bad for Utah.
Very bad. Not great.
Yeah, I'll tell you. I mean, we talked about it with Jaquinda Jackson, right? It's like sometimes their guy is just bigger and faster and stronger, and he's hard to tackle. And there's like that's why college football is so great, is that sometimes that guy happens. Yeah. You know, sometimes the Bo Jacksons, sometimes the Cam Newtons, sometimes the Tim Tebows, sometimes the, you know, the Marcus Mariotas. Mm-hmm. And it's sometimes every now and then those guys come through and they blow us away and they're on another level from everybody else. And if that's what he is, then yeah, that'd be awesome. And I'm excited to get him a year before he's going to be that guy. I don't know.
Yeah.
Let's see it first.
Let's see it. Do we want to talk just what we're watching week one? Like week one viewership? Do we want to talk about that real
what
quick?
What are we watching? Okay, so other than Utah, what's your number one game?
Oh, man, I'm tuning in to that Notre Dame-Ohio State game.
I mean, it's going to be hard because it starts 30 minutes after the Utah game. You're going to have a heck
of
a time watching
it. I'll pull a Chase Kennedy. I'll have that on my phone.
Yeah.
I'm sure they'll have it in the press box. I'll be in the press
box.
Oh,
you'll be in the press box, so you'll have, like, Wi-Fi and stuff. Good point. It won't be like the lowly fans down there trying to stream it.
Yeah,
trying to stream it in the swamp.
Their phones held up above.
Do you think
heads.
The humidity is good or bad for a signal?
I would think it helps, right? It's not necessarily
signal gets
a
there faster.
Yeah,
faster through the water.
Yeah,
in the air.
That's what I think.
Yeah, no, that makes. Yeah, no, I think we can agree there. So the cell service
there.
In the swamp, you have cell service
it
will be
kills
phenomenal.
People, but it helps the cell signal.
Correct.
That's
yeah,
fantastic.
I mean, which yeah, trade offs.
Future
you know,
looks bright.
You know, trade offs.
Shout out to humidity.
Okay. Any other games that you're interested in?
Let me look at the schedule. obviously, Oregon, Georgia. That
yeah,
one
I think that's my big one. Oregon, Georgia is my big one. I am interested in Ohio State or Notre Dame at Ohio State. I think Ohio State's going to be really, 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 really good
so
this year.
Good.
And
if
so
Jackson, I would love it if Jackson Smith and Jigba just like went for 400 yards.
He might, like he could, he very well could.
I would give
Stroud,
him an NIL. I would like DM him and be like, bro, like, can I give you an NIL deal for like $10 and just say like
from the
out.
Blockcast, we could do that.
We could do that.
I don't think anyone would care if we did that. I think he has endeared himself enough to Utah fans after that Rose Bowl that we could give him an NIL. I think
if
they would
he
be
gets
upset.
300, 400 yards against Notre Dame, we'll do it.
Yeah, we'll sling him something.
Yeah.
Something small.
Yeah.
Man, other than that though, I it's been a long episode. My brain is broken. But yeah, Oregon and Georgia is my other big one. I don't really have any delusions that Oregon can win that game, but
no
I'm
way.
Curious to see what they look like against what will be I mean, Georgia lost a lot, but they're just they're so talented.
They got Stiquavius Bennett, just, at quarterback.
They're just so talented.
Have you seen Stiquavius Bennett?
Physically?
No.
Personally?
Since he got his haircut.
Since he got his haircut.
I'm not kidding, bro.
No, what?
Stetson Bennett got a haircut? He got that low top fade?
No.
Yeah.
And?
Stiquavius Bennett.
And, okay, what? Wait, okay, seriously, what do you, like, what is your, I want in your true, we'll put it in the Peep the Fit, we'll put it in the Peep the Fit channel of the Discord. What are your true thoughts on Bennett's fade?
No, bro. This ain't it.
This ain't it?
This ain't it.
Thank you, next.
So, anyways, excited to see Stiquavius take the field this season. and on that note, like, man, excited, man. It's game week, baby.
We made it.
We're here.
Thanks for joining us. Like I said, please follow us. Please share us with your friends.
Remember, at Florida Utah Fan, tailgate Saturday. We'll be there. Come out. Let us know that you'll be there. Come have fun. We'll have fun. We'll have a good time. This has been the Utah Blockcast. Signing off.
Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.